So you've got all those smart home gadgets installed and all your smart home accounts set up to control all those gadgets, and now you're concerned about security. Well, stick around because I'm going to talk about that and some things you can do to help protect yourself. So let's get to it. This topic doesn't really specifically talk about smart home devices, but it talks about how to secure those devices. And as you've been building your smart home, or maybe you haven't started yet and you've been investigating it and you realize there's a lot of accounts you have to create, and you see all these reports about people hacking into cameras and taking over people's accounts, it can be a little daunting and it can sound a little scary for sure. But there's a few things that I'm going to talk about in this video to help you secure and protect those accounts so that you don't have to worry about that. Nothing is 100%. One question I always pose to people is, do you leave your house without locking the doors and closing your windows? And 99.9% of the time, people say, absolutely not. I lock my house when I leave because I don't want anybody to get in. Well, your digital information is just like your digital home. You need to be able to secure it and lock it and protect it so unwanted people don't get in. And you're wondering, well, how do I do that? Well, we're going to talk about that. Unfortunately, there's not just one account to be able to have all your devices in. There is, you know, when you have Google, for example, you do have the whole Google ecosystem is protected by your Google account. Apple HomeKit, same kind of situation. Now, I don't have any Apple products. I've never used Apple HomeKit. But I do know that you have to secure those accounts. You have Samsung SmartThings, Philips Hue. I mean, look, the list is gigantic. It's huge. There's so many different types of devices and accounts that you can create to build out your smart home with all the different types of devices that you want to use. Switches, bulbs, lamps, TVs, you name it. There's probably something that's smart. It's got some kind of smart brains in it that you can use. But one of the first things to do is create a strong password. Don't use a weak password. You want to use something that's at least 8 to 10 characters long. Longer is better. You want to use at least some numbers, capital letters, lowercase. But one thing I would suggest you do is use a phrase. So for example, now you wouldn't want to use this because it's too basic, but my smart home devices. Use that whole phrase as your password. Again, don't use that phrase because it's too simple. I'm just using it for an example. You want to think of something a little more difficult. Three words that aren't too long, but they mean something to you that you'll remember them. Those types of passphrase passwords are much harder to crack if someone's going to try to brute force your account. But at very minimum, again, 8 to 10 characters, preferably 12, numbers, capital letters, lowercase, special characters. You want to incorporate all that into your password. So that way you're making it as difficult as you can for someone to try to, you know, guess it using, you know, there's tools out there they have that will do these brute force attacks. So you want to make it as hard as you can for that tool to be able to guess what your password is. Then most importantly, and to me, this is the most paramount aspect of all of this, is two-factor authentication. And you absolutely should set up two-factor authentication if your account supports it. Now, unfortunately, there still are some manufacturers and vendors that don't use two-factor, which I think is absolutely insane. There's no reason not to. It's easy to implement. It's been around for a long time. And even if you just do a simple text two-factor, that's really all you'd need to do. However, if you can use an authenticator app like Google Authenticator or Microsoft Authenticator, there's others out there as well. But if you can use an app like that, it makes it even more secure because you're not typing anything in. It's a direct communication, a secure communication between the service and your phone using this two-factor code that you have to put in to the service in order to get logged in. Every single one of my accounts has two-factor set up and active on it. My Google Authenticator is full of two-factor codes. And I understand that security can be inconvenient, but think about how inconvenient it would be to try to recover your accounts, if not virtually impossible in some cases. You don't want to have to go through trying to recover an account that somebody else has been able to breach and hack and get access to. And with a high prevalent phishing attempts still roaming the emails of everybody's inbox, you want to have that extra protection, because some of these phishing attempts are extremely thought out, very well made, and they can even trick some seasoned veterans. There's been a couple that have come across my inbox that I've had to stop and pause and look at it and go like, is this legitimate? Because this looks really good, but there's always something. It's always something in the verbiage or the link. If you look at the link, a lot of times you can just hover over a hyperlink. And when you do that, it shows you the entire path of that hyperlink. So when you look at that link, for example, if it's going to google.com, right? And it says google.com on the link, you go, oh, it's google.com. Well, if you hover over that before you click on it, if it says my fish website, google.net, whatever the case may be, URL, don't click it, because it's going to take you to a phishing site that's going to want you to put in your username and password, and it's going to want to get that information. One of the biggest ones that is going around is for Microsoft accounts, because so many people use OneDrive to share files that they'll send an email saying, hey, so-and-so, and it might even be somebody you know, because maybe their account has gotten breached. But you'll get an email that so-and-so has a file that they want you to read or look at, or a picture, or whatever the case may be, and it looks like it's behind a Microsoft OneDrive account, and that it requires you to have a Microsoft account to open it and look at it. So then you have a Microsoft account. You go, oh, I have one of those. And you type in your username, which is typically your email address. You type in your password. You click sign in. Nothing happens. Or it might say, oh, invalid password. And you'll end up typing it in again. Well, what you're doing is you're actually giving your username and your legitimate password to that nefarious actor that's wanting to get that information. Now, without two-factor, you're not going to know. You're going to think, oh, the link didn't work. Something's wrong with the link. You're going to have no idea that somebody's logging into your account. If you have two-factor turned on, you're going to get a prompt on your phone or whatever method you're using, right? And if it's not you actually signing in, all you got to do is decline it and then immediately go change that password. Because if someone else is trying to log in, that means they have the legitimate password. Because if it was not the right password, they would never get the prompt. You would never get it. It would just say invalid password to whoever's trying to log in. But if they're successful, you're going to get the prompt on your phone to enter that two-factor code. And you're going to be like, I'm not logging in anywhere. So you just decline it, change your password, no harm, no foul. Very, very important to have that security in place. You know, a lot of these services require, you know, subscription fees or one-time purchase of something. And you should also set those kind of alerts up on your credit cards so that if something is happening, that someone's using your card and it's not you, that you get an alert on it. I have been able to thwart a couple of, you know, breaches where someone has somehow cloned my card number or whatever the case may be. And I remember one time I was sitting at lunch with my family and we were in Louisville. We weren't even at our house. And I got an alert from my American Express that my card was just used at a store in Michigan. I think it was at a Target. Well, I know that I'm not in Michigan and I'm not shopping at a Target. So I immediately went into my American Express app and I froze my card. It wasn't 5 minutes later, I got two more charges where someone was trying to use my card at a different store for a much higher amount. But of course it was declined because I froze my card. So, of course, I immediately called American Express, told them what was going on. They reversed the charges. They investigated. I didn't have to pay, you know, whatever the fee was or charge was they were trying to charge. But again, if I didn't have those alerts set up, I would have no idea until suddenly I have all these charges on my bill or they max my card out or something. And so again, your digital life is something that you should control to the best of your ability. People say all the time, well, I don't do online banking. I don't want to be on the internet. I don't do any of those things, so I don't need to worry about it. Well, that's not true, because if you have a credit card, whether you pay it by mail or not, it doesn't matter. Your information is on the internet. If you have a social security number, your information is on the internet. If you have a mortgage, a car loan, anything like that, you're already on the internet. So why not take the proactive steps to secure that information so that you can control what you can control, which is your sign-on, two-factor, those things. All of these accounts that you're going to be creating to create your smart home is very, very important that you set that up. Like, for example, with your Google, if you're using the Google ecosystem with the Nest products and things like that, that's secured by your Google account. So make sure that you have a strong password and that you have two-factor set up in your Google account. And actually, Google has where you can use passkeys. And I'm not going to get into passkeys in this video. Maybe I'll cover that again in a different video. But you can Google it. You can check it out. It's a little more secure method of signing in as opposed to having a password. They also support hardware authentication. So, for example, I have a little USB key that I carry around on my keypad, or excuse me, on my keychain. And when I sign into a device or onto an account and it doesn't recognize the device I'm signing in from, it's going to say, insert your USB key. So I can insert that key, validate it with my biometric thumbprint, and then it'll sign my account in. I do that all the time because, again, I want to protect my information as best I can protect my information. Now, again, if I don't have my key with me or I can't use that for whatever reason, maybe the device I'm signing on doesn't have the correct port for me to use, I can still then use a secondary method of my authenticator app or a backup code or a text message or something like that. But it's important to secure those accounts. Now, I know, again, this video is not a smart home device or technology specific type video, but I got to thinking the other day, I see all these breaches. I personally have been notified, your AT&T account has been part of, our data breach. This account has been part of this data breach. And it's just the world we live in. So it's important to monitor and protect yourself the best you can, which I almost forgot to mention. There's one other thing you can do to protect yourself, and that's to monitor and lock your credit bureaus. You have Equifax, TransUnion, and Experian. And all three of those companies give you the ability to lock your credit bureau. So for example, let's say in one of these breaches of one of these companies that I can't control, they have my social security number and my name and my address. And whoever has that information tries to open up a credit card, let's say in my name. They can't, because in order to open up the credit card company is going to want to pull a credit bureau. Well, you can't pull a credit bureau on me because it'll say, hey, your credit bureau is locked. You need to unlock your credit bureau before you can apply for credit. Now, how do I know that works? Because sometimes when I go to apply for a loan or something like that, I forget to unlock my bureau and it'll decline because my bureau's locked. So I'll have to log in, unlock it, then go back and reapply and, they'll be able to pull the bureau. So I know it works, and you can do it with all three of your credit bureaus. And again, it's also important that whether you lock it or not, you can set up alerts, right? So if somebody pulls a bureau, you'll get an email or a text message saying, hey, your credit report was just accessed by XYZ company. And if that wasn't you, well, then you can investigate, you can, email the credit bureau, you can, lock your bureau at that point. And kind of pay attention to what's happening so that if something shows up in your credit bureau, a card that you didn't sign up for, you can report that and they can close that account. So again, it's inconvenient to have to go through all that. I get it. I do it all the time. But I guarantee you, it's way more inconvenient to have to go through and try to recover your accounts or get your identity back or close credit cards that you never opened, whatever the case may be. And that's going to affect your credit rating, because if they charge all this up and then, of course, it's not getting paid, right? All of a sudden, now you have, you know, late notices, and it's just a mess. It's an absolute mess. So I just wanted to, you know, make this video to kind of make you aware that you need to do that, and it's important. And control what you can control, whether it be for your Google Nest account, through your Google account, whether it be your Philips Hue account, credit cards, whatever the case is, control what you can control. Security is important. You don't leave your house when you go to work. You don't leave it open. You don't leave the doors unlocked. You don't leave the windows open because you don't want anybody in your house. Well, lock your digital house. Lock your credit bureau down. Lock your cards down where you get alerts. Put your two-factor authentication on your accounts so people can't just randomly log in without you knowing it. And use strong passwords. Those things you can control. All the rest of it you can't control. But you control those things. You control a huge aspect of securing your digital home. So I'm going to put some links down in the description to some information where you can go, you know, look, investigate, you know, like the pass keys or something like that, or, you know, how to set up two-factor on your Google account, things like that. That'll kind of guide you through some of the steps. It's not hard. It's very easy. But you just have to make sure you have the information in place so that, for example, and I've done it, like I've wiped my phone, gotten a new phone, forgot to transfer my two-factor codes, and now I have to go back through and set them all up again, which is a real pain. So keep your backup codes and not have to go through that. So it's just important. But I'll put links in the description to some helpful things that I think would be something you can use to help guide you to, you know, getting it set up or whatever it is you want to do. And, you know, if you have any questions or comments, hit me up in the comments section. I'll be happy to give you any more information. This is what I do for a living, so I understand the importance of this, and that's what made me want to make this video. It's not anything fancy, no super cool devices or neat tricks that I can come up with for my smart home and some stuff I've added, but this is probably more important than all of that. You set those things up first, and then you can go in and start getting all the fancy stuff and doing all your fun stuff, and then you just don't have to worry about it. You don't have to worry about someone watching your cameras because they don't have access to your account. That's how they get access to the camera, is through your account, because they breach your account and then they get access to your camera. So lock it down, secure it, and you're good to go. Listen, I appreciate you watching and interacting with the channel. Don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button. And again, let me know if you have any questions, comments. I'll be happy to help you. And you'll definitely want to go watch this video here, which kind of goes over some security aspects with cameras and locks and things like that that you could put on your home.